My name is Carlita, and I wanted to talk to you about ecotherapy. I'm an ecologist and an environmental biologist. I've been working 11 years in the environmental sector. I can honestly say that no matter what you do, even if you endeavour to try and preserve an area of rainforest, for example, something will happen. Someone's going to come along and attempt to plough it up for oil all over again. You need to be eternally vigilant when you're working as an environmental conservationist, because the key root cause of environmental problems, the environmental crisis that we're currently a part of and that we are currently causing, is due to human consciousness. The environmental crisis is a crisis of human consciousness. So, having worked over a decade in environmental conservation and then only 3 years as a therapist, I can say that I have probably helped more in supporting the wild or the environment through my therapy work, which may sound strange to some people, but the fact is, if we create more internal peace for people and ourselves, if we can create inner peace, then we remedy much of the external destruction that we're seeing in the world today, manifesting from our internal sickness and unrest. Which is why I want to talk about ecotherapy and its benefits. Repression of the ecological unconscious is the deepest root of many of the psychological, social, ecological, spiritual and physical problems in contemporary industrial society. Ecocidal policies do not only attack and devastate external nature, but our internal natures as well. This is why eco-psychology or ecotherapy talks of restoring the earth and healing the mind. This is a quote from Theodore Roszak. We are taught by society that we are separate from nature or even superior to it. We evolve with this separation in our mind and hearts, creating a growing and deeply profound unrest emerging within us. We feel something is missing in our lives, so we spend our time filling it, seeking to fill it, with emptiness of buying more things, overeating, other addictions such as drinking, taking drugs. Perhaps we need to fill the vacuum with a new lover, maybe. On and on, continuing our search, but never satisfied with what we have. Wanting more and more, and leaving further deepening of being unfulfilled, and apathy, depression, loss, anxiety and despair, which is rooted in society's belief that we are separate from nature. So, are you one of the few who realizes that the hidden origin of a deepening emptiness and sadness is rooted in our belief that we are separate from nature and other creatures on the planet? Western consumer society teaches us to reject the value of the natural world and sabotages our yearning for a deeper connection between our inner voice and the natural world that gives us our mind and hearts the inspiration to feel whole again when the healing force of nature's self-correcting peace, balance and beauty soothes our soul and reminds us of who we are again. Learning and teaching how to authentically reconnect our thinking with the web of life is the solution. The mutually beneficial familiarity it produces is the best remedy for our unreasonable prejudice against nature. It is a powerful way to increase personal and social environmental well-being, says Dr. Mike Cohen. As Western society is very highly pressured, it can leave us feeling unfulfilled and stressed with an unsatisfying life. We have these insecurities, addictions, various disorders, anxieties, all feeding off one another. And our illusion of feeling the separation from the natural world is part of the reason why we have all these issues. Ecotherapy is profoundly healing. It's essential for grief, emotional and mental trauma, abuse, addictions. It can make us feel empowered, confident, nurtured, and a sense of inner nourishment, cultivating inner peace. The core of the mind is the ecological unconscious, where our natural feelings of connection to the world of nature and other organisms rest, connected to what biologist E. Edward Wilson calls biophilia. The emerging synthesis of ecology and psychology. Other therapies seek to heal the alienation between person and person, person and family, person and society. Eco-psychology or ecotherapy seeks to heal the more fundamental alienation between recently created urban psyche and the age-old natural world, human and nature, and cosmos are one being, not separate entities. The application of ecological insight to the practice of therapy. Eco-psychology or ecotherapy is the reevaluation of certain compulsory masculine character traits that permeate our structure of political power and which drives us to dominate nature as if we have a dominant right to rape the earth, and as if we are alien to the earth. In this regard, ecotherapy draws significantly on the insights of the sacred feminine with a view to demystifying the male and female sexual stereotypes. In addition to seeing the earth as a consciousness made up of ecological units that make up its whole organism, much like the organs of the body. We are part of the earth's consciousness, and she is the deeper fabric of our mind's consciousness in the web of life. The study of our emotional bond with the earth. Ecological mind or ecological ego matures towards a sense of ethical responsibility to the planet that is as vividly experienced as our ethical responsibility to other people. It seeks to weave that responsibility into the fabric of social relations and political decisions. However, the corporatization of the political world has become unethical and careless to a point that it has no responsibility to protecting the planet. unconsciously we take on this violation and violence to the earth. We are carrying the burden of its responsibility. We feel grief, guilt, anger and loss even, especially when we see ecocide unfolding on a daily basis with destruction of the rainforests and the pollution of our oceans, along with the systematic poisoning of the air we breathe. We need to find ways to heal when we are feeling powerless and overwhelmed with the ecocide that we are living in and are a part of on a daily basis. The search for an environmentally based standard of mental health. For eco-psychology, as for other therapies, the crucial stage of development is the life of the child. The ecological unconscious is regenerated in the newborn's enchanted sense of the world. Ecotherapy seeks to recover the child's quality of experience in functionally sane adults, including through the experience of being in the wilderness, in inner nature, connecting us with the magic that we sensed as children, fairies and legends, with myths and magic and woven stories passed down from our elders, with ancient knowledge of plants and medicine from our medicinal plant doctors and shamans. Ancient magic and ancient knowledge, we've lost that connection with the earth through systematic violation and repression via religion and corporatization of medicinal plants. We seek to reconnect with that magic. We seek to see the fairies and the mythical creatures. We seek to restore the connection that we need to be true. It still exists in nature. The magic never went away, it was always there, we just unlearned that it was real. We were taught that it was unreal. As we grew up and became separate from nature, we lost that magical connection. Our connection with the earth is in itself a magical potency that keeps our spirits nurtured and centered. So redefining human mental balance is in the symbiotic ecological equilibrium with nature, earth and the web of life. Open access to the ecological unconscious is the path to sanity. The contents of the ecological unconscious represents to some degree, at some level of mentality, the living record of evolution. Tracing back to the distant ancient conditions of history, the evolution of the human mind, eco-psychology deeply questions the essential sanity of our current modern-day urban, industrial, civilized society that has created rapid changes that we are still attempting to adapt to whilst we are destroying the planet at such a high rate. We are living in the sixth greatest mass extinction right now. For example, the Amazon rainforest alone is vanishing at a rate of 20,000 square miles a year, and that it is estimated that between 17 and 100,000 species each year are becoming extinct due to our current lifestyles and our current level of consciousness. So again, the ecological crisis is a crisis of human consciousness. So I would just like to finish with an extract from Dieter Dehn's book, The Sacred Matrix. In 1979, the British biologist James Lovelock published the Gaia Hypothesis, according to which the entire Earth may be a unified organism he was on the right track of a fact that goes much further. Not only is the Earth itself a living organism, it also spins around a living universe. The universe is alive. Everything in the universe is imbued with spirit, and everything is an expression of universal life. The Earth itself is a living body, an acting living being with a soul and a consciousness of its own. Therefore, in principle, if we choose the right frequency, we can enter into direct communication with her. All beings in the biosphere are expressions of the soul of Mother Earth, and all have been birthed by her energy, her temperament, and her joy of life. The Earth is suffering in a real way from the destruction that humans inflict on it. Sometimes she quakes and shudders, resulting in earthquakes or volcanic eruptions. They are the result of energy movements that she carries out on her surface in order to heal herself or at least ease the pain. We need to fundamentally change our ideas and ways of thinking. We have learned to not think animistically, i.e., not to project any mental or spiritual beings into our environment the way early primitive cultures did. We now begin to understand that our entire world, from the pebbles to the galaxies, is filled with a great universal world soul. We have further learned that we shouldn't think anthropomorphically, i.e., that we should not project life processes that we know from humans onto other living beings, and especially not onto dead matter. We now begin to understand that we ourselves are cosmomorph, i.e. that we are the same movements of life occurring through us in an analogous way as they do in all other things in the universe. We are just like the oceans, the rocks, the plants and the animals, a part of the hollow movement which encompasses and permeates everything that exists in an infinite ladder of scales and energy levels. We have learned that organic matter contains no life, and that we can therefore use it for any purpose. We are now beginning to understand that it too is a condensed form of universal life, and a state of universal energy, and that it takes part in the universal flow of one life and one consciousness. There will come a time when future generations cannot understand what their ancestors, i.e. we today, did to the Earth. May a new movement for a free Earth see to it that this time comes very soon. We cannot limit the healing work that lies before us to healing nature or healing the human being. We must unite both areas of healing, for in both cases it is one life that is wounded, as outside, so within. The ecological outside of nature and the psychological inside of humans are two parts of the same whole. Outer destruction goes hand in hand with inner impoverishment and alienation. Ecological devastation and human devastation are two sides of the same global overall disease, and it can only be correctly understood and overcome by being viewed as a whole. If peace workers of the future become aware of these connections, then they know that they serve the Earth when they create peace within themselves. They also know that they serve themselves when they see to it that living creatures of the Earth can live and breathe freely again. We give thanks to these insights into our inner connections for still shining and blessed world. So we are moving from from one paradigm of destruction and illusions to a paradigm, a new movement of truth, of awakening, and a new science which unites spirituality and consciousness. And you see this emerging through the work of scientists and biologists like Dr. Bruce Lipton, Nassim Herman, Christopher Bird, and Peter Tompkins published a book called The Secret Life of Plants in 1973. It was work that scientists revealed that plants have a consciousness just as animals or people, and plants can respond to emotions and human thought, and even respond in empathy to other plants being destroyed or other animals being destroyed.
So the sound here that can be produced by the plant is by creating a difference of potential, of electric potential. And now she's going into the, yeah? Is creating the signal that is making the music now. It is the plant changing the notes, the melody, the rhythm. The electrode, the plant, will not sing anymore. This was an experimentation in Damanhur since 30 years to see if plants are intelligent beings. And we were trying to find out if it is possible to dialogue with them, and the result was not only a signal, yes or no, or I am alive or not, but a very complex of expression of music that is a universal language. So plants can express themselves, giving us a feedback for to our emotions. That is how they dialogue with us. They can, on a kind of telepathic connection, read and understand our emotions. And it is possible to talk to plants also without the music. You can use your own senses, go to the tree and talk to the tree as well. Anyway, here during researches, it was possible to take this signal from the plant and to decode it by this device that has been produced by our own, and then by a MIDI signal. It is sent into a synthesizer. Here the plant is given a musical instrument where it can interact by changing the melody, by choosing the notes and the rhythm, the musical rhythm.
Is the plant reacting on her own music that she's producing?
Yes, she is.
Okay.
They like, plants like music and they like their own music. So, as more as they play and they listen to music, as happier they
and
are.
Joyful
as,
and...
Yeah, as more they play. They can learn to make music. We teach them for 2 or 3 weeks, making them listen to classical music and doing meditations together with them. And then they learn to, at a certain point, they become aware of they can produce their own music. And that is a moment where they start very happily to create. And that musician plants, generally, we take them with us when we go to give concerts around where we want to make music with a tree on a territory. We put our musician plant near to the tree and there is a connection between plants, between tree and plant, and there will be the transmission immediately from the knowledge by the plant, by the musician plant to the tree. And the tree is immediately able to make his own music. So this is how we organized concerts in the woods with 3 or 4 plants playing together, making music, and human musicians. Singers and dancers also, creating a very inspiring and particular atmosphere with this. So plants are intelligent beings, and they have just a different way of being. They have a different logic.
These experiments alone just illustrate the immense power of consciousness. Then you've got Dr. Emoto's work on water, Dr. Masaru Emoto and his research on how human thought affects water, creating crystals. Again, consciousness flows through all life. It even flows through water, which is a life-giving substance. So, ecotherapy is really an exploration of consciousness, deep ecology, Gaia hypothesis, and psychology, uniting science, consciousness and spirituality, and reclaiming our connection with the earth. Thank you for your time. Thank you for listening.
Other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I think nature's imagination is so much greater than man's. He's never gonna let us relax.
We live in an in-between universe where things change all right, but according to patterns, rules, or as we call them, laws of nature.
I'm this guy standing on a planet. Really, I'm just a speck. I'm just a speck compared with a star. The planet is just another speck. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space.
There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks. The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together.
cosmos is also within us. We're made of sparks, but we are away. The cosmos can know itself.
Across the sea of space, the stars are alert. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
We're all connected to each other biologically, to the Earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
Find it elevating and exhilarating to discover that we live in a universe which permits the evolution of molecular machines as intricate and subtle as we.
In my body are traceable to phenomenon in the cosmos that makes me want to grab people in the street and say, have you heard this?
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of sparks, we are away. The cosmos can know itself.
There's this tremendous mass of waves all over in space, which is the light bouncing around the room, going from one thing to the other. And there's more really there, really, really there. But you gotta stop and think about it, about the complexity and really get the pleasure. There's more really there, really, really there. The inconceivable nature makes you. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space. There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of sparks, but we are away. The cosmos and know itself.
Across the sea of space, the stars are alert. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.